Hi, it's me. I haven't been in touch with a lot of people lately because obviously everybody is quarantined at home. We are living in the age of COVID-19. It's April 24th of the year 2020. I don't think anybody expected that this year was going to be not only a year of reflection in terms of hindsight, but a year of foresight, a year of having to look forward to we don't know what for the first time. It's always been generally easy for us to say, well, things are generally getting better or things are generally getting worse. But this is the first time in my lifetime, the first time in 100 years, that the entire globe is struggling with a global pandemic, where every soul will be touched, where everyone is involved, where there is no immunity, where we're on our own and yet sequestered together, as it were, as humanity. I used to think that the only thing, literally the only thing, that could bring the world together, the whole we're in this together mindset, which I see so much of now, that it would be the arrival of the galactic family en masse around the world, so that everyone would just simply look up and, yes, that would do it, but so does COVID-19. I don't think of it as World War III. I consider this to be the paradigm shift. I consider this to be what so many spiritualists have been forewarning about, the coming of a new age of enlightenment, the coming of a new awareness of a complete realization of oneness of all of us in the same boat simultaneously. It's been an amazing and a transformative time for so many of us as we reflect on our own mortality, as we think in terms of life and death in ways that were not so in our face even a few months ago. I remember in January, it was January 24th, in fact, so it was 3 months ago, I was sitting reading an article from a major publication about this virus that was circulating around Wuhan province in China, and that so many people were falling ill and dying so quickly from it. A palpable fear was spreading around the globe even at that time. Anybody that was aware of what was going on knew that this was very serious. And I sat back in my chair and I said to myself and my little dog who was there, this is it. This is it. It's the paradigm shift. Nothing will ever be the same on the other side of this. We will all have been fundamentally changed by the experience. Some of us will survive it. Most of us will survive it. Many of us will perish. And I realized that all my anxiety, all my angst in the latter part of 2019, when I was so angry and feeling so hopeless about the escalation of aggression between the United States and Iran, I thought that it was a precursor to a coming war, which could conceivably have evolved into World War III. And I was frightened and I felt powerless to affect any positive change. And all I could do was watch the news and wring my hands and hope for the best and pray that this did not turn into what it looked like it was going to turn into. And then it went quiet. It went quiet. Like the adult in the room said, you kids knock this off now. And I breathed a sigh of relief. And I wondered what was happening behind the scenes that was causing such an immediate quell in the threats that were being ushered back and forth. And I dared to relax a little bit and thought, whew, that was a close one. And we all had Christmas together and our family gathered and we all hugged and kissed on each other. And, you know, it was just a delightful holiday season in spite of having just, whew, you know, it was lovely. And then this. There is a possibility, based on the fact that I was so sick last fall and into the winter, that I've already had this, because whatever I had was bizarre and lingered for weeks and required medical attention, some pretty intense stuff, which I didn't share much of. I didn't put that out publicly, but it was a struggle. And I'm so glad that that's over. I won't know until I'm able to take a test whether or not I have the antibodies. That will tell all. I need to be sure that that test is accurate. That's still up in the air right now. So I have to be patient. I have to wait, just like all the rest of us have to wait. But there are things about this virus, this insidious, secretive illness that is so pervasive, that is sweeping across this country and the world with such speed, light speed, that it really makes me wonder if everyone has, you know, the same awareness of its the lethal nature of it. We thought at first that it was claiming the eldest among us, and that turned out not to be the case. We've known for several months that it's communicable in an aerosol way, like walking past somebody who's breathing out. If you're too close and breathing in, you can actually acquire the infection. We're learning as we go about this virus. We have to increase the testing exponentially. We all know that. We all know that this is a very dangerous time to be alive. Even going to the grocery store can be a hazard to your health. But in the midst of this darkness, I'd like to shed just a little bit of light. I want everybody to think about those moments that make you smile, that bring some brightness in. It's been a time that has either shocked and stunned people into morbid silence or has brought out the lighter side of humanity and the kindness and the goodness we see so much of every day. People doing things for each other, caring about each other, watching out for each other. So ironic that the kindest thing that we can do for one another is to stay away. But that's the truth of it. But last week, Dad and I went to the grocery store. And that's something that, you know, you have a little bit of hand wringing and it's like, okay, let's make a list. We'll get out in and out as fast as possible. And I had actually just asked him if he would just drive me over there. I would run in, get what we need, and come back out. No, Papa Perrin's got to come into the grocery store with me. So I made him put on his N95 mask, which he struggled. I had to show him how to do it. And we went into the public supermarket, the next town over in Ocoee, Florida. And we were in the produce department. And there's my dad. I should have taken a picture. There's Dad with his mask on and leaning over the produce. And I was near the bananas, so I was a good 20 feet away. And I yelled over, "Dad, do we need cucumbers?" And he couldn't quite hear me, so he turned around and he pulled his mask down and he said, "What did you say?" I'm like, "Dad, put your mask back on. That's not how it works. The ears are on the side of your head. The mouth is here." Well, everybody around us just lost it, just laughed. And you could hear the laughter ringing out through the muffled face masks. And he just looked at me and just shook his head like I had spoken to him in some different language that he was unaware of. But he finally, I was like, "Put the mask back up." And he did. And I walked over to him and I said, "Do we need cucumbers?" The answer was no. We actually had some. As we were cashing out, which we made it quick, you know, in and out, got what we needed. And as we were cashing out, I was trying to move in front of the cart so I could unload from the front, Dad could unload from the back, lickety split. And as we were passing through, the clerk that was standing behind me, I kind of brushed up against her back end a little bit, and I turned and I said, "Oh, pardon me." And then as I got to the other side of the car, I just looked at her. I was probably 5-6 feet away from her at that point. And I said, "You know, I understand that we're not supposed to have face-to-face contact, but no one said anything about cheek-to-cheek." And everyone around us laughed, and I could see her eyes dancing. That's all I could see of her face, were her eyes dancing. "Hello, honey." And it was a precious, tender, sweet little moment in the midst of darkness. It was a little flicker of light. And that's what I think we all need to strive for. And I'll tell you what's gotten me through. This little buttercup, my sweet little buttercup, whoops, has, do you still have my audio? My sweet little buttercup has gotten me through the very worst of this so far, even though it's only the end of the beginning. So if you see me moving around trying to keep her at bay, it would be Buttercup that wants to know why she's not involved with our filming today. "You're my sweet girl. Yes, you are. Don't lick my lipstick." So now she's happy because she's in the shot. I would encourage anyone in a position to do so to go out and get yourself a dog or a cat or any creature that you can cuddle and save a life if you can. So many of the shelters have emptied out during this 6 weeks or so since we've come to our senses and gone indoors and stayed put. She came to me in early January before this even happened when I was up in Georgia as a rescue. And I didn't want a dog. I didn't. I travel too much, or I used to. And I didn't want the extra responsibility with so much else going on in my life. But the universe had another idea. And so Buttercup came into my life. And she's been the center of my universe ever since. So I guess my message for today with this little vignette is just simply to be the light you seek. Try to raise the frequency. Try to stay upbeat as much as you can. I'm going to spend some time talking about fear, rational fear versus irrational fear. This is rational fear. We're facing it. This is it. This is the paradigm shift. Holy shift. This changes everything. But as we each fundamentally change through this process, we transform in myriad ways. Not only have we literally altered our existence to accommodate this secret, silent plague, we have also come to understand how valuable we are to each other, how much we enjoyed gathering in huge groups of people. Well, not me so much. I avoid stadiums. I do paracons instead, which is enough, and it's great. But, you know, humanity, we're very social creatures. And this physical separation, this social distancing that we're going through, I think has brought a lot of people to a new awareness, how much we enjoy each other's company. We add up the numbers, but the numbers reflect people, individuals who have perished, who leave behind devastated families. And I think all of us feel for them. Before this is over, all of us will have lost someone we know, or we will have lost our own lives to it. It's an imperative that we face. We are literally confronting our own mortality as one across the planet simultaneously. It's a lot to think about. So, in the interim, as we process the information coming to us day by day, moment by moment, news cycle by news cycle, let us pause and reflect and take a moment to think about the moment that we're in. Think about the grass beneath our feet, to think about the daffodils and the sunset that we're free to watch because we're not in a high-rise building in an inner office closed out from the world around us. Let us take a moment to reflect on the light that beams forth from within each of us. So, in this moment, in what so many of us perceive to be a very dark moment in our human history, let us be that glimmer of hope. Let us be that light that we each seek. Let us be lighthearted when it's so easy to be downtrodden. Let us dare to hope that there is another side to this. And when we get there, life will be very different, but it can be blissful because we can make it so. And with that, I just give you my love, my heart, and my hope that we will all find our way through this together.